There's something about the piercing hot, because in Albuquerque and New Mexico, the ozone layer, you're up much higher. Mm-hmm. No smog. It comes down and it's like pinpricks sometime, yeah. The heat. You know, when you're in production, the sound always is like the redheaded stepchild. It's like, no, as long as the picture is good and the acting is great, yeah, it's fine.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden you get in post and you go, it's not, pay close attention to all the elements of filmmaking.
That's it can the change the thing. Entire game.
It really can, yeah.
So do you not feel like the most beloved man in America these days?
I certainly am, you know? I certainly feel like... At 56 years old, I've become the pretty girl in the bar, you know, where people come and they, I'd like to talk to you. Really? Really? Wow. You know, who knows? I never would have guessed that at this stage of my life that there would be this level of opportunity coming my way, but I'm certainly appreciative of it.
So do you feel like you're now, in terms of films, because in this film, you're kind of the foundation of the story. You're kind of the...
I'm glad you said that. It's really about Jack O'Donnell. It's really from my POV, and then they go off and do some things, but it's really... The story really picks up when you see me on the phone. Come on!
But you're the tether. You're the Robert Duvall, for lack of a better term.
All right.
Film.
Boy, that's nice.
You're the guy they call into and find, you know, in Houston when they have a problem.
Well, it's like a touchstone. There's a little bit of that. And, you know, my character is a composite character, so it's not a specific person there, but an amalgam of people who have worked with and around the CIA for a number of years. And they felt that it was important that when they came back in intercutting, that it's not with a different person each time, the massiveness of the CIA, but that we got a little name face recognition. And and then my character is a mentor to Tony Mendez and that sort of thing. So
do you like being that? Is being that guy the next step in your career? Is kind of the go-to guy everybody knows and kind of likes and has a built-in?
Oh, you mean as an actor or as a character?
As an actor.
Oh, as a I wouldn't it be nice if it's let's go to him, and then if I have opportunity to, you know, to be able to be more selective on the projects that I choose and whom I like to work with. I think that's the best of all worlds.
Is it good scripts? Is it great character? Is it, what is it that draws you out at this point?
It's always story. Mm-hmm. Story's number one.
The entire story, not just your character's story.
Yeah, absolutely. And this was a very compelling story. But if it weren't for Chris Terrio's masterful handling of this screenplay, it wouldn't have been as an easy choice for me. I read that and I went, wow. I want to get in to talk with Ben as soon as possible, because I know actors. And actors who read the script of Argo are going to be clamoring to get into that room. So I need to get in there first, lift my leg on a few, you know, I want to claim things. And I want to be ready. So when I went in, I had some ideas. I read the Wired magazine article. I was familiar with the circumstances and the political climate of the day. And I knew I would have to be on my game, because Ben is really smart. And he's very passionate about this story and the storytelling of it. So there was no thought that I would just come in and say hello and how are you, and oh, it was a nice office. I really wanted to go in there and prove to him that I'm his guy.
So even if you can go into an office and say, hi, I'm Bryan Cranston, hire me now, you know, sign the check, you're probably not going to be going down that road, it sounds like.
Well, in a way, you do that. In a way, you go into the office. If you really want the job, it's still an audition, even if it's just so-called a meeting. Mm-hmm. You go in there, and I wanted to fill Ben and Grant Heslov with the sense of confidence that I could do this and that I'm the best choice for this. That's what I wanted to walk away with when I met with them. And so in order to do that, you need to have a take, have a point of view, so that you're not just some actor coming in and, you know, sipping your ginger ale or something, but you have an opinion of something. And take a chance and say, "What I think he might be like this. You know, I think the relationship might be that."
So do you want to be pushed as an actor when you make choices? I mean, obviously you love the script, but are you looking for something that will push you into some other place? Or are you just interested in the research? Or are you interested in what's turning you on is before you even walk into that room?
It depends on what's necessary. If a character is close to whom you are in real life, there's really less awareness to be had. It's kind of like, oh, I am this guy. Mm-hmm. Or in the sense of Jack O'Donnell, I thought, I can get behind this guy. I can find out what makes this man tick, a lifelong servant of his country, a patriot, but no less. I mean, he's still a bureaucrat in all the sense of the things, and mm-hmm. in more of an administrative role. He's no longer in the field. Some frustrations and some sense of accomplishment with that. Now I have one of my proteges out there, and his life is in danger, as well as six other people. And the CIA officers that I've talked with, they are, to a person, very committed to that credo of we don't leave someone behind. An agent of the CIA is a friend of ours, and we have a duty and a responsibility to do everything we can to make sure that they are safeguarded.
So do you spend much time with actual guys?
Yeah.
Is it like we're at a bar and not pretending we're not actually who we are? Or?
It's interesting that you mention that, because like any other work environment, they have their bullshit that they got to deal with, and orders that come down that they have to comply with that they can't figure out what the hell, or one hand doesn't know what the other hand is doing. There's always a sense of that when you're working with a large corporation, which, you know, the CIA really is a large corporation. But by and large, they are people who are very sincere and earnest in their desire to seek accomplishment in their fields. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, in the case of Argo, I hope that the men and women who are with the CIA will watch this and go, you know, there were some liberties taken, mm-hmm. which have to be taken in any filmed entertainment. But I hope, by and large, they look at it and say that was honest. They treated us fairly, and we're grateful for that.
So do these guys come to you with their defenses up, and you have to break them down and get them to be people to have the conversation, or?
CIA officers are by nature a little more close to the chest, not necessarily very loquacious. Mm-hmm. You know, being talkative is bad for a spy. Mm. There's a lot of things they can't talk about that are classified still. Mm-hmm. And I think they were a little, not off-put, but a little surprised perhaps that my angle and my level of curiosity and questioning mm-hmm. was more toward the personal side. What does this affect? How does it manifest, this life of secrecy mm-hmm. in your day-to-day life? How do you deal with your spouse when you come home for 3 months after not talking to her or him mm-hmm. and still not being able to reveal what you did during that 3 months mm-hmm. That you spent an entire career not talking about your career? Mm. That would naturally put some, you know, segregation between your spouse and yourself. And how does that work? One guy says, well, it didn't work very well. I was divorced twice. Mm. Another said, well, I married a CIA officer. And I go, I get that, because actors intermarry actors a lot. And it's because...
You get divorced a lot, too.
Yeah, you can get divorced. I suppose there's any level of temptation, perhaps. Maybe more so in an acting realm, because mm-hmm. we meet so many other people. We're, you know, on Breaking Bad, I'm making out with Anna Gunn and kissing, but my wife is an actor, and so she's like, hey, is that fun? I said, yeah, it was fun. But and with no threat right. toward our relationship. Mm-hmm. And because I'm able, especially when you get older, you're able to categorize those things. This is work, this is reality. Mm-hmm. And know how to keep them separate.
My guess is you learned that actually as a child.
Do you?
And that there's something in your, well, I think that your personality, I think, I mean, I don't know you, obviously, we've just met, but I think people's personalities allow them that opportunity more than getting older. I mean, getting older changes it a little bit, but I think that, you know, I'm sure there are people who have a very hard time keeping church and state so clear.
Yeah, in their... but I think everyone, every human being is prone to temptation and susceptible to it, given the right set of circumstances. So it's just, you know, as I think children are basically selfish. That's how they're born. Mm-hmm. Self-interest. And we as parents and members of society, we have to be taught at early ages what is appropriate, what is good, what is bad, right from wrong, has to be taught. And same thing in a marriage. You know, you have to say what it, you know, if someone asks me, a gorgeous woman walks by and someone said, would you like to have sex with her? My answer is, of course. Of course I would. Will I? No. Will I attempt? No. Mm-hmm. But the basic bottom line truth is I'm a guy. And that's, you know, that's the truth. And it doesn't mean I love my wife any less. Mm-hmm. It's just the truth.
So the way you have these conversations with these CIA guys and the way you research that, is this a method of working that has been consistent through your entire career? Is it something you've developed over time?
It's something that you develop, and it's taught, certainly taught, in acting classes and theater workshops and things like that. And basically, it's a form of backstory. To me, it's very easy. Mm-hmm. I am more comfortable in presenting a character if I know as much as I possibly can about that character. Mm-hmm. Therefore, it goes from being outside of you to being inside of you. Mm-hmm. The more you know, it's like being fed. Oh, and then he's this, and my Jack O'Donnell in Argo, I wanted to make him a practicing Catholic. He's twice divorced. So there's a certain amount of guilt about that battle. Mm-hmm. There's a certain amount of thought about, am I put out to pasture now that I'm not on the field anymore? Mm-hmm. How do I like being an administrator as opposed? So I keep feeding that guy until I feel that there's a foundation. And then the character is inside of you. And then when you hear or read or another actor reads a line, mm-hmm. you're reacting as your character because you're comfortable in his skin. But if you didn't do that work, for me personally, maybe others can do it, but for me personally, I need to do that work to feel that level of relaxation and comfort in a character.
Should you do that with a comedy or, you know?
Yeah, it depends on the size of the role.
Right.
I just did a cameo on 30 Rock, and I didn't have to go deep for that. It was really pretty much on the surface of what I was able to do. Makes it fun, not a whole tremendous amount of work necessary to go into it, and you play and you go and have a good time.
Is it a good thing that it took you to a certain age, till your 40s, to have your first big hits and become a brand, as it were?
Yeah. I mean, I was perfectly happy being a working actor since age of 24. It's the only full-time job I've had since that age. And
it's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
And one that I'm incredibly proud of. The idea of making a living as an actor is if you get a tap on the shoulder because someone saw you do something and you, oh, we'd like you to do, oh, wow, fantastic. Mm-hmm. And that's the way it's always been for me, and that's the way I'll always keep it. Mm-hmm. So that you don't develop a sense of entitlement, that the world owes you anything, that this business owes me anything. They don't owe me anything. You get it by every other job that is earned. You have to work for it, and you have to study for it, and you have to be open to it. And if it's supposed to come your way, it comes your way. If not, it doesn't. Mm-hmm. So it really releases any kind of pressure that you have on yourself, or for me, that I just don't focus on things I can't control. I just don't even think about it.
Were you that way when you were 30? Maybe you...
That was that way. As far as the business is concerned, I had this epiphany when I was about, it was about 20 years ago now. I've been working for 33 years. Mm-hmm. So it came to the point where I would allow outside influences to adjust who I was or what I needed to do that day. Mm-hmm. I actually thought, and this was the biggest mistake, and my biggest note to any young actor, when you go in for an audition, you are not trying to get a job. If you associate an audition with trying to get a job interview, you will ultimately fail. If you can grasp this and nothing else, this might save your career. It'll save your sanity.
So what are you there for?
You're there to do your job, which is to create an interesting character and present it. That's what an actor does.
So you're already working in the audition.
This is your job. Actors work all the time. We create and present and audition. That's acting. That's work. That's our work. Mm-hmm. And we're presenting constantly. And we have to think of it, we have to grasp it and nurture that this is what we love to do. So from that point on, I was not like, oh, an audition. It's like, ooh, an audition. I get to act. Mm. And my job is to present that. And then also what it does is change your point of view. You go in there to give someone something, mm-hmm. not to try to get something from someone. Huge distinction. So the energy that you have in giving a present mm-hmm. or giving of yourself, of your time, is far more self-assured and confident than it is if I want to get something from you. Is there anything I can do, anything else I should do that mm-hmm. you would say, yes, give me the job? That kind of energy no one wants to see. Mm-hmm. But they do want to see confidence and an ability to present something and then walk away.
So now that everybody is getting a present from you on a pretty regular basis.
I didn't want to make it sound like it's a present.
But it is a good analogy.
It was the image of giving as opposed to receiving.
Absolutely. More fun now? Or?
Oh, it was always been fun.
It's a little easier to perfect work.
It's tremendously easier because I truly have no sense of competition with that. I go in to present a character to someone, and if a friend of mine or someone else I know gets it, it's like, great. You know, Robert Patrick, I was talking about doing this role in Gangster Squad, mm-hmm. and I couldn't do it timing-wise. Mm-hmm. There was a mix of schedule, and Robert Patrick got the role. And instead of going, oh man, I wish I could have, even though I like the script and I like everybody, well, I went, oh man, he's going to be terrific in that. And I absolutely mean it. In fact, I think Robert Patrick is a better choice for that role than me. I honestly believe that. And I thought he's going to kill that role.
But he seems to have figured this out too. I mean, he's working more now than, he went from kind of being a gimmick in the T2 thing, and now he's like really working constantly.
I don't know if I can call it a gimmick. I mean, that T2 thing was...
Well, but I mean, it was a moment, and it was like people often lose those moments because...
Yeah, I mean, it was then Robert's challenge to not allow himself to be cast as that kind of thing right. anymore. You have to say, that was good, that was that, and now I have to look into other opportunities.